Let's start then by taking a look at the best 11 from Game Week 25. And we start off with none other than Jordan Pickford in goal after taking home all three bonus points in Everton's win in the Merseyside derby. And look at that from the FPL legend that is Stuart Dallas, this week's highest scorer with 17 points after getting a goal in Leeds' 3-0 win over Southampton. We also had some big scores in midfield. Harvey Barnes managed a goal and an assist in Leicester's win over Villa. Rafinha delivered in his double. Marcus Rashford and Bruno Fernandes both managed 12 points against Newcastle, whilst Ademola Lookman scored his fourth goal of the season. And up front, yes, that is Christian Benteke. He's made the cut despite my protests after that 95th minute winner against Brighton on Monday night. And that's the last we'll be hearing of him in this show.
That really was an extraordinary, extraordinary bit of football. Well, so now we should have a look at the most transferred in players for Game Week 25, the previous game week. Because as you can see there, the fact that Southampton and Leeds had an extra fixture was really, really influential on this. You had Saints Ings up there as the most popular player transferred in, and then the three Leeds players. Now, the Leeds players all delivered. Rafinha, Bamford and Dallas all scored on Tuesday against Saints. For anyone, though, of the almost 250,000 people who brought in Danny Ings, it was a bitter pill to swallow, because once again he and Saints failed to deliver.
Yeah, it was really disappointing, and then to see him sat on the bench for the start of that second game against Leeds was just a nightmare if you've gone in for him this week, because I think for a lot of FPL managers that brought him in for 25, they brought him in for 25 with a plan for him to become Calvert-Lewin or somebody else for game week 26. So now you're kind of in a position where you've invested a lot of money in him and you're probably going to have to take him back out again.
Yeah, not good. Let's talk about that Leeds trio then that James just mentioned, because they all delivered. Dallas, Bamford and Rafinha. David, isn't it nice when a plan comes together like that in a double game week?
Yeah, it's fantastic. I mean, yeah, all three of them. The thing with Leeds, I was very impressed with, was that we were sat here last week talking about how we were a little bit worried about what they would be like without Calvin Phillips. And obviously, they've shut me up, absolutely, because they kept a clean sheet. Not complaining, because I do actually own two of these players. But yeah, it's interesting, because sometimes you can get a little bit sucked into a double game week. I kind of think that Danny Ings was very much one of those decisions that people have made. But the great thing about the Leeds players is that if you have got sucked into the double game week, they still offer you fantastic value beyond it, not just because they're a great team and they're good for fantasy, but of course they're going to feature in that game week 29, which is really important.
Yeah, Sam, did you have all three of those guys?
No, I had Dallas, I've had Bamford for a while now. Rafinha was one that I looked longingly at for quite a long time and thought, well, can I find a way to bring him in? But I just couldn't quite make it work in terms of the budget. Lee did, and he captained him. And actually, he was really unlucky that, because he could have scored a hatful if they'd have finished some of the chances that he created in that first game.
He could have had 30 points.
He was unbelievable.
So what do we do with them now? Because, Dave, you were just pointing out they don't have a double fixture this time around. They've got a game at home to Aston Villa, who are not in the best of form. So that could be productive anyway. But the other thing, as you mentioned, is that in a couple of game weeks' time, game week 29, they are one of the eight teams that will have a fixture. And I think they're against Fulham that day.
Yeah, it's really handy that they're there. I mean, when you look at this phase of the season, we've already talked about the fact there are lots of people having to navigate this period without the chips. And Leeds are one of those. There's always a team, isn't there, that can help tick several boxes in one go. The fact that they've got a single game week fixture against a team that's, you know, defensively lost Matt Cash and not doing as well at the back as they were.
Right.
You know, you can still trust Bamford, I think, to get a goal there. And also, because they don't have Grealish either, so maybe you can trust Dallas to get another clean sheet. It's very helpful.
So you would definitely hold on to them for 29, but you might also use some of them this week.
Yeah, I think I'm going to bench boost two of them, to be honest.
Because okay. If you don't have your bench boost, though, would you have any Leeds players in your 11?
I'm going to play both of mine, and I don't think I'm going to bench boost this week.
Crikey.
Oh, I love it.
They've won 19, 20 straight, something like that. They've got double game weeks coming up, but back-to-back double game weeks. Basically, for FPL bosses, it's time to man up. We need Man City players, and we need loads of them. But which ones do we need? We're going to have a quick check through now the most essential players from Pep's platoon. Let's have a quick check on the fixtures first of all. As I mentioned, four games coming up in the next two game weeks for the Citizens, and they're all at home. Oh, my goodness. So, first of all, this game week, it's West Ham at home and Wolves at home. And then, as you can see, Man United, yeah, the derby, but then a Saints team that's currently in free fall. Crikey. Now, the safest thing with all that rotation question that we always have with Guardiola seems to be to get in defenders. David, is that what you've done?
Well, yes, although I own Cancelo, who's the one I'm most concerned about not actually playing all four of those games. So, to be honest, if you've got like a clean slate, you're wildcarding or you're free hitting and you want to tackle these double game weeks without having gone into them with pre-existing kind of commitments like I've done with Cancelo, then for me, Diaz is the main one to look at. We've seen that Stones can miss games now that Laporte is back. Diaz missed one, but it was after he'd had an illness.
Right.
So then for me, I think that played an impact on him missing a game. He's going to play more games than Stones. I mean, one person we haven't talked about, I suppose, is Edison. He doesn't get talked about too much. He'll play all those games and he might even take a penalty. So.
Well, yeah. And it's funny because, Sam, you're even considering, or at least you said you were considering, bring him in for this week.
Yeah, I did say that when we did the pod together. I think that Edison, for me, if you're going to double up at the back, DS, I agree with you, he's the one I own. I think Edison looks like a really nice pick. He's guaranteed to play when the other two just aren't. I think there is a huge amount of rotation that will happen, not just around the Premier League, but their FA Cup commitments, their Champions League commitments, the League Cup final that they've got. Edison and Diaz, for me, are the double up at the back I would go with.
Are you going to bring him in, though?
If I could budget it, I would. But I would need to take a hit to bring in Edison, because financially I just can't get from where I am with Nick Pope to Edison without taking somebody else out as well. So I don't think I will, but it's only budget that's stopping me doing that and not wanting to take a big hit for it. Hmm.
OK, let's take a look at some of the Man City attacking players. And this is where it gets a bit trickier, because we just don't know who Pep Guardiola is going to play. But one thing we do know is that Gundogan is currently the most owned Manchester City player. He blanked last time out. He played 90 minutes in the Champions League on Wednesday. But for all the managers that have him, surely you have to hold him.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, a lot of us are now at the point where we actually have quite a lot of value tied up in him, because, I mean, I signed him when he was 5'6", and he's now 6'1". So if I was to move him on for a short term, that'd just be crazy. But also, why would you sell a guy who could actually play three out of the next four in the next two game weeks? Like, the risk of moving him on is just, you're surely going to sell some points within that. The Champions League is a concern, because I actually felt that he wouldn't play. I thought the Mönchengladbach game was a game that Guardiola could afford to bench more of his better players, because they were kind of favourites for it and it's like an easy Champions League game, but he's thrown them all in. I'm going to hold Gundogan, but I am also going to, I said a few weeks ago actually, that you were probably going to have to take a few benchings on the chin and roll with it, because Champions League's coming back. So.
But it's not entirely a question of game time for Gundogan, is it? Given that Kevin De Bruyne's return might see us revert to a different kind of Man City or a different kind of Gundogan with the same kind of lack of returns that he used to have before this incredible period.
It might do. He was scoring goals before KDB got injured. So I don't think it's a case that De Bruyne went out and then Gundogan started performing. He was already performing before we lost KDB. I think it does depend on how he sets up in terms of, does he play a proper number nine? Does he try and put Gundogan in a false nine? Does he play De Bruyne in a false nine? Like, there's so many variants in the way that Pep can set up his team. But Gundogan does seem to be a pretty much ever-present. And I suspect that, as David said, he'll play the majority of those four games in a way that I don't think you can say about the likes of Mahrez and Foden, and even probably Sterling as well.
OK. So Gundogan did play in the Champions League. De Bruyne didn't, which I guess is a big indication that he's due for some major minutes in the Premier League. He's only owned by 11.5% of managers at the moment. This is a pretty huge opportunity to almost have a differential KDB.
Yeah, I think so. And we've seen that he can even play false nine now in a way that helps him get even closer to the goal. Mm. One thing that he's always been famed for, of course, is assists, and he always will have that in his locker. But previously he had to, shoot from the edge of the box or maybe take a direct free kick, and that was where you would expect the goals to come from. But in the games that he's been fit for over the last few months, we have seen him play in this advanced role. One of the games that Sam was talking about there, actually, against Chelsea, he played false nine, got a goal, and also Gundogan played in the advanced role as well. So I think if you have De Bruyne and Gundogan together, I think that's a hell of a combination. And you feel comfortable captaining De Bruyne when a lot of other people can't get him in because they're focusing maybe too much on Spurs or maybe too much on Man United and Liverpool. So massive opportunity, especially with four games and two game weeks.
Mm. Yeah.
Sam, you mentioned a minute ago about Sterling. You think that he is probably more likely to get less minutes than Gundogan, for example. But he has had three double-digit hauls this season. Yeah. Is that a good thing, or is that not enough from someone of Sterling's price?
And I think that's the difference for me, is that to invest in Sterling, you've got to pay a hell of a lot more than you have to invest in Gundogan. So when Gundogan plays three out of four matches, you can kind of take it a little bit more because it's not taking up so much of your premium budget. Whereas with Sterling, you're making a decision to have him as one of your premiums. That probably means you're not having somebody like Salah or Kane or Son or Bruno Fernandes. And those guys are guaranteed to play every time their teams play because they're so vital to them. And that's why Sterling, for me, just feels like a risk that KDB isn't, because I think at that price point, he will play every week that he's fit and available. So I find Sterling difficult to invest in for that reason.
OK, but on a lower price point, you have got other midfield options like, say, Riyad Mahrez or Phil Foden or Bernardo Silva, actually. Can you make a case, and it would have to be a brief one, but can you make a case at all for any of those three?
Well, I mean, that's handy because not really, no. When you've got the others, they're just more likely to play. So it's hard to say yes to any of those three.
OK, only got three berths, so they've got to go for the guys at the back and the likes of De Bruyne. Yeah.
It is the biggest double game week in FPL history coming up in game week 26. We're all looking forward to it. So let's try and get some other big players that we think are going to deliver in this double game week. And let's start off with Tottenham, who face Burnley at home and Fulham away. Sam, let's go to you first on this one. Harry Kane, is he a must-have?
He is for me, yeah. His record against Burnley and Fulham is exceptional. He's played 14 times against the two of them combined. He's scored 14 goals, got three assists, including a brace in this fixture last season. It's a no-brainer for me. I can't understand not getting him in.
It would be the money, I think.
I think so. Yeah, and I can see that. And I could see why at his price point. But a lot of people have got a lot of money in the bank. I think it's who you'd have to take out. So I made a big decision last week to take out Dominic Calvert-Lewin for Kane. Calvert-Lewin also has really nice fixtures. But for me, Kane was the one that I felt was a real must-have for this game week.
Is it too risky not to have Kane in your team when you're looking at those games against Burnley and Fulham?
No, I'm not going to get him this game week. For me, it's a little bit about money, but it's also about team structure. I don't want to break my team for this guy, and there's a number of reasons why. Now, he does have a good record against these teams, but for me, the timing doesn't feel right. I haven't really watched Spurs recently and thought, I really need one of these guys, because they aren't attacking with as much success as they have done earlier in the campaign. And in the last four matches, Burnley and Fulham have actually been quite good at frustrating other people. So in that period, Burnley have only conceded two big chances. Man City are they're level with Man City for the fewest big chances conceded in the whole Premier League. That's Burnley. Fulham have conceded five, so they're in the top five. They're two teams that know how to set up a deep block. And a team that Spurs' form is in right now, I don't know if I can trust him to break it down in a way that means he's going to absolutely smash it. I think he will maybe get something, but not enough for me to break my team. And the other last thing I worries me about this game week is the goalkeepers. Pope and Areola are the top two goalkeepers this season for XG prevented. Every save they make has a score based on the quality of the chance saved, and they're the top two for that stat for the whole season. So he's going to have a hard... If he's going to get something, Kane's going to have a hard two games because he's going up against two very good goalkeepers.
And if he's going to have a hard two games, what does that mean for Son Heung-min Son, who seems to have lost his touch, like his Heung-min touch, you might call it. only one goal in his last eight games. Yeah. I'm considering taking him out,
Sam. Oh, James.
I am.
I think... So I do agree with what David's just said about Spurs. They haven't been on very good form lately. However, the second half against West Ham when Gareth Bale came on, there was a marked difference in the way that Spurs attacked. It was a different performance from Spurs between the first and the second half in that game. We saw Kane go back into that traditional number nine role while Bale was kind of doing the collecting and creative part that Kane normally does. And in turn, I think we could have had a very different conversation sat here had Son won that he hit off the post gone in, had Kane scored the couple that he had. For me, I think that these are games where, again, last season, Son scored in this fixture against Burnley. They could be teams that go well. Bale didn't play the whole of the game in the Champions League. I suspect we'll see all three of them start in the Premier League against Burnley this weekend. And if that happens, I suspect there'll be goals.
OK, let's switch now to Manchester United. They have Chelsea and Crystal Palace away from home in their double game week. We know they're very good away from home as well, David. Look, it's interesting because we've all got Bruno Fernandes in our team, so there's no question there whether you should have him. But should we double up and get Marcus Rashford as well for that impact?
Yeah, I mean, doubling up can have a big impact if you want to try and turn what I like. Fernandes is like a shield, effectively. He stops you from taking a rank dip. And if you can get the guy, that means that when you do get a goal for the guy that everyone has, you get the assist or the goal, if he's got the assist, then, yeah, it's very effective. Would I pick Rashford as my next kind of way to do that? I'm not too sure, because I don't really like Man United's double game week as much as I like some others, because it's very, you've got an easy game, I think, or a nice game against Crystal Palace, but... Yeah, the other game, Chelsea, I think that's going to be 0-0. Man United, whenever they play the big teams this year, Liverpool, Man City, basically ever since they got thrashed by Spurs, I think they've completely changed how they take on these big teams, and they've all been 0-0 every game they've played against these top six sides. And the main reason they don't do too much going forward is because Fernandes plays a much deeper role. He's very good at it. I still think he's the best player in the pitch in those games. It's just he plays a more defensive role, and that just, for me, negates what Rashford could then provide.
OK. What about Aston Villa, who do have two very potentially productive-looking fixtures, Leeds and Sheffield United away? They also have the fixture, we've now got that confirmed, in game week 29, which makes their players more attractive, the likes of Martinez and Watkins and that. But the continued uncertainty about Jack Grealish, what does that mean for all the other assets?
It's not just Grealish, though. It's also Matt Cash, who's out till the middle of March. Matt Cash has been so vital. I think one of the reasons why Martinez has been so good this season is because he has had consistency in front of him. Those back four have been there week in, week out. They know each other in the same way that the Liverpool defence did last season. It was constant. Same players. They knew, they trusted each other to be there if they'd gone forwards. Without Matt Cash, the last couple of weeks, the goal led a charmed life against Brighton, who were incredibly unlucky not to win that game. And then, of course, last week they lost to Leicester. So that worries me a little bit for Martinez. Having said that, they're playing two teams, particularly in Leeds, who will attack at every given opportunity. So if he keeps a clean sheet, he's likely to get the bonus points as well, because the save points will be enormous for him. Mm. Watkins without Grealish worries me a bit. We didn't see a lot from him without Grealish in game week 25. We don't have any certainty around whether Grealish is back or not. So if you own Watkins, I'd hold him for the double, particularly with 29 in play. Would I bring him in? I'm not sure. It's one of my discussion points that I've got to have with myself as to what I do with my team for this week.
OK. Finally, Leicester. They face Arsenal at home, Burnley away. Harvey Barnes is proving very popular. Back-to-back double-digit returns, Sam. But with the speculation that James Maddison could miss out due to injury, does it make Barnes less appealing?
It does for me. Maddison, for me, is the main man, even above Vardy at Leicester. He makes the play tick. He connects the defence with the midfield, he connects the midfield through to Vardy. Harvey Barnes has been playing more forward alongside Vardy in a number of games, and that's because of the work that Madison's doing in the midfield. If he's not there, I worry about the productivity that Madison, that Harvey Barnes and also Jamie Vardy will get as a result of that. It'll be interesting to see how it pans out. I think the fixtures are there to take a punt on Harvey Barnes, as long as you're thinking ahead to 29 as well, because he doesn't play in 29. So depending on your chip strategy, it might be that you have him for now, but you need to remove him again in 29.
We're joined now by Bakar Sadiq, a.k.a. Big Man Bakar, from the FPL Wire podcast, all the way from Pakistan. Great to have you with us, Bakar. Thanks for joining us. How excited are you for the biggest ever double game week in FPL history?
Thanks for having me on, Jules. It's a pleasure to be on board. I feel humbled to share space with an enormous lot of talented analysts and fellow contributors. And I look forward to engaging in the discussion tonight ahead of what is the biggest double game week in FPL history.
All right. I have to say, Bakar, you do look like a big Bakar. You're filling up your area of the screen nicely there. You've got some big differential picks as well that you're going to unleash on us. And may I say thank you so much for doing this, because you've been very imaginative. First one is the Fulham goalkeeper. Not a lot of people would have suggested this, but I can see you thinking. Explain anyway, Alfonso Areola.
Yep, so I suggest Areola because Fulham have kept three clean sheets in the past four matches. Their defensive stats are improving. They're up against Crystal Palace this week, who, despite having scored twice against Brighton, had the worst XG this game week. And a Spurs side, who are at the bottom two for big chances and XG over the past six games. So I think there's a good chance that a Fulham defensive asset could come up with FPL points, FPL returns this week.
OK, Bakar, I'm a big fan of the next player that you've picked out for us, Marcus Alonso. You think he could be worth a shout, don't you?
Yeah, for sure. Alonso, we've seen he has pedigree in the past. Since Tuchel has taken over, he's top among defenders for penalty area touches and shots inside the box. So his numbers are really great. Chelsea, during that period, are second only to City for big chances conceded and XG conceded. So there's possibility that he can deliver points at both ends of the field. The thing with Chelsea is they keep like so much of the ball there. They're averaging 67% of the possession under Tuchel. So they're bound to sort of give away less chances to the opposition.
Yeah.
But Kai, another player that you've highlighted is Ricardo Pereira of Leicester, who is kind of FPL gold, really, in the sense that he's a defender who's playing now as a midfielder, and he didn't start this week in the Europa League for Leicester. So that makes it look like he's very likely going to be starting at the weekend.
Exactly. And as we speak, James, he's less than 1% owned. He's only 0.9% ownership. And wow. And I noticed in the game at the weekend that he was playing on the right wing. So he's out of position, and his average position was as advanced on the opposite wings as Barnes. And after the game, Rogers mentioned that Pereira is likely to continue playing with Castagne, because he expects Castagne to hold the width and Pereira to come inside. So that bodes well for his goal threat.
Mm. Yeah, he looks a really good option. You've also gone for West Brom's new striker, Diagne. We've only seen him very recently in the Premier League. So why have you picked him?
So whenever we talk about a West Brom attacking asset, we tend to think that Allardyce adopts a pragmatic defence-first approach. But actually, West Brom under Allardyce are 10th for big chances, as opposed to 20th for big chances under Bilic. Diagne is second for XGI, expected goal involvement per 90 among forwards over the past four games. And ever since he's starting playing, he's top among all players in the league for big chances. So he's definitely going under the radar. And with a good set of fixtures coming up, I think he can do really well.
Bakar, I want all of them. Let me ask you a couple of other things but before you leave us. One is, are you playing any chips this week? And secondly, who are you going to captain?
Yes, I'm on a bench boost this week. I've already played my triple captaincy, unfortunately, under Bruyne. This week, I'm on my bench boost. I wildcarded in the previous week just to set myself for a bench boost this week. My captaincy is a bit undecided. I don't own Kane, so I'm likely to go with either Bruno or Son. Bruno is a safe option, I think, because, I mean, he's the FPL, undisputed FPL king. Since his debut, he's 59 points better off than anyone else. In terms of points, and he's averaging 8 points per appearance. So what more can you ask for? He's as safe as it gets.
Okay, yeah, even with that fixture against Chelsea. Interesting. Bakar, thank you so much for being with us. Look forward to hearing from you again soon. But in the meantime, best of luck.
Thanks,
for,
Bakar.
As you say, the biggest double game we ever. Crikey.
Thanks a lot. It's a pleasure to be on.
We are focusing now on Everton. So let's start off by taking a quick look at their fixtures coming up for the double game week. It's Southampton and West Brom in game week 26. After that, a tough fixture against Chelsea, but then they have Burnley. They do blank in game week 29. And then they have Crystal Palace at home in game week 30. But for the double itself, David, would you say they've probably got the best fixtures?
Yeah, I mean, the fixture combined together is really nice. I mean, some of the other bigger teams are playing maybe like one decent team and then one more favourable team. Everton are really the only team that have some semblance of like reliable form to a point, because they are a little bit unpredictable. They just have the best balance between some form and great fixtures.
Yeah.
OK, good time for Calvert-Lewin to come back into the picture then. Last weekend, coming off the bench, winning the penalty against Liverpool. Seems to be over that hamstring injury. What do you think of him? Is he a must-have coming into this double game week?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I'm thinking I may even captain him. I'm not completely decided yet. But I think there's a strong possibility that he can do something, because, as you say, he's back and he's fit. And Everton generally just offer more threat when he's able to be a focal point for the attack. And actually, we saw in the last two games, there were two big wins against bigger teams. They were quite good on the counter-attack. And I think that Southampton and West Brom will have to attack them, because West Brom need the points. And Southampton generally play quite an intense game. Neither of those two teams are going to set up in any kind of deep block or what have you. So they've shown that they can expose space behind some of the best defences in the league. So why can't they do it against some of the worst?
Mm. Sam, you're not as convinced by Everton and, by extension, Calvert-Lewin.
I just worry about Calvert-Lewin if the rest of his team don't perform as well. So we've seen Everton have had a bit of a rollercoaster season. At times they have been absolutely brilliant and at times they've just been awful. And there's no real consistency in that. Like, it's so up and down, you can never tell from week to week what Everton side you're going to get. They were fantastic in the Merseyside derby. Will that translate into these games this time round? I'm not sure. If James Rodriguez has a quiet game, if Richarlison doesn't play as well, if Luka Dean is busy defending and isn't attacking so much, Calvert-Lewin will get less opportunities. That kind of thing worries me. He's not, on his own, the most creative of players. He does brilliantly when there's creative players around him, but he won't create that many opportunities for himself. And therefore, his reliance on the rest of his Everton team worries me a little bit.
If Richarlison does play well, though, is he a good differential pick? Because he's owned by around about 7.5% of managers.
Yeah, he definitely is differential. And if you are looking to climb overall rank, if you are looking to go up your mini leagues, Dominic Calvert-Lewin isn't necessarily going to be the one that does that for you. Richarlison could be. He could be the one that gives you that opportunity. But I think of the two of them, Calvert-Lewin feels like the more likely to return. And he will be creative, he'll do all the right things, but it's probably going to end up being Calvert-Lewin that's on the end of those if he creates the chances.
Okay. The other Everton player who I think loads of people are interested in is Luka Dean, who's got 8 assists already this season. Last 4 appearances, he's had 20 crosses from open play, which is obviously massive potential for returns there. What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, if you're looking for a double game week defender that you feel can do well, he looks like a good bet, because we've seen Southampton and West Brom struggle to score in some games. I mean, I actually kind of fancy West Brom to score more than I fancy Southampton the way that they're playing at the moment. But either way, there's clean sheet potential there. The stats you mentioned there about the crossing is great. And actually, the combination between him and Calvert-Lewin is also good. When they play together, they complement each other really nicely. Mm. Simply because, high balls into the box, that's what Calvert-Lewin basically lives on. Southampton are actually especially bad at defending down their right-hand side. So in the last 4 matches, they're in the bottom 5 for conceding chances down that side. So when you consider that actually Everton's most effective and most productive flank is their left, that marries up quite nicely. So there's a good opportunity for Digne to expose Southampton, especially in the first game of the double game.
Teammates. Adam Ola Luckman. He scored the last game, so hopefully continue the good form. Adam Ola Luckman. Because he's on corners and he's a very clever player. He's good at creating opportunities. I'll say Adam Ola Luckman again. Because obviously 1v1, he's very sharp. He knows how to beat a man. And yeah, you're very direct, very quick. Can I put 2 answers for this one? I would say tossing to score. He's very tall, so he's able to head the ball well on crosses and corners and set pieces. And Ola to assist, because obviously Ola, he's up and down the wing, gets crosses in, gets in good positions, and obviously assisted my first goal. I would say Ivan Cavallero. I've seen him in training, he's very good at free kicks. I'm going to say Joachim Andersen. Yeah, he's aggressive, knows how to use his body, and as a defender, you're going to give away fouls. Harrison Reed, all-round player, hard-working, leader. Obviously very technical, can pop up with a goal or assist.
Chip chat indeed. It's a huge week in FPL, biggest double game week we've ever had. Loads of you going to be using either free hit or the wild card to just furnish all the best players. So we've asked Sam and Dave to come up with a kind of hypothetical, a draft free hit and wild card team. As I say, these are hypothetical and they're also done with their team budget, so might not be exactly the ones that work for you. But anyway, let's have a look at what you've done. Thank you so much for this, David. You're first with the free hit to draft.
Yeah, the free hit chip I think can be massive this week because not many people have it left, and you can really get some of the players who maybe only have the decent for this particular game week. And one I particularly like the look of, and it's taking people by surprise that I've chosen him, which is weird because it's Trent Alexander-Arnold. I mean, you know, he's got the pedigree, as we know. In the last four matches, he's actually third from all defenders for chances created. So I think there's a possibility that he comes back into the four anytime soon. And the free hit's the best time to make the most of that because you don't have to break your team to actually afford a defender at 7.4 million. Luke Shaw he's top among defenders for chances created. So when you do these free hits, I think it's really important to target those defenders that you feel can get attacking returns. So Shaw and Alexander-Arnold are ones that really stand out for me. Such as the changing nature of FPL at the moment, I'd probably make two changes to this team, even though I've already submitted it. The Champions League lineup in midweek has made me waver on Sterling. I would probably put De Bruyne in there. And of course, the Madison injury makes Barnes a better option for me as well. But Gundogan, I still want to leave him in because I still feel like he's going to get used significantly in these games. He plays an important role for Man City. And of course, the price is great in terms of what it unlocks elsewhere. There will be people who say, where's the Spurs assets? Well, Pope is one of the reasons why. I think Pope is a fantastic goalkeeper when he plays against the bigger teams. And, of course, playing against Spurs, you actually haven't produced as many shots as you'd maybe like. When you think about his save percentage, it's very high. His XG prevented is the best in the league. I think Pope is going to do really well this game week. And, of course, just to round it off, we've got Mbaye Diagne down the bottom there as well. Like Bakar, I really like the stats behind this guy. Not only is he doing well among forwards, he's also the fourth best among all players for minutes per expected goal involvement in the last four matches. He's had three of his last four have had attacking returns in for him. So I think, yeah, he's got the making of a double game week differential.
Brilliant.
Very nice. All right, Sam, you've put together a hypothetical wildcard team. The difference between that and the free hit is that you've also taken into consideration the game weeks coming up as well when you've put this together.
Yeah, and I think that is a big difference because the moving of Aston Villa and Spurs into game week 29 means that if you're free hitting, you might be able to free hit this week instead of saving it for 29 because suddenly you have another wealth of teams that you can pull from. So there's three Spurs in there. They have a nice set of double game week fixtures, even if David thinks that they won't get any attacking returns. I happen to disagree, of course, but there you are. I think that, you know, Reguilon, back from injury, rested in the Europa League this week. I suspect he'll be able to play in both games coming forwards. And they're against two teams that haven't been scoring a lot of goals, so there should be clean sheets and there's always attacking return potential from him. Marry him with Kane and Son, who play in game week 29, and have nice fixtures and you're kind of set. I agree with everything you said about Luke Shaw. I think he's been a fantastic pick and I've owned him for quite a while now. The attacking potential that he has, and earlier we were talking about, you know, who do we pair Fernandes with? For me, it's Luke Shaw. You pair the two of them together and you get the upside of Fernandes because attacking potential from Shaw is huge. Gundogan, I think, is a keeper for the rest of the season. He's going to play regularly. Salah, I keep for now because the fixtures are nice till game week 29. But at game week 29, when he doesn't play, there's an opportunity there for a change to the likes of KDB, I think, if we don't see Salah starting to do something over the next couple of weeks. The Villa boys stay again because they play in 29, even without Matt Cash and Jack Grealish, who we mentioned earlier, and keep these guys nicely on the bench ready for game week 29.
Time for our experts to reveal their actual teams. We just saw what they would do if they potentially wanted to use the wild card or free hit chip. But Sam, let's take a look at how you're actually looking heading into the double. What are you going for?
So this is them. I have one free transfer that I still haven't made yet. I haven't yet decided what I'm going to do. Pope could become Martinez because of the game week, with game week 29 in mind, and also keeping a double game week with blank 29 in mind, sorry, with also keeping double game week 26 in mind. Antonio, I'm not necessarily wed to. I might move him on this week because I'm not going to play him against Manchester City. He will likely become Watkins, maybe even I might take a little punt on the West Brom forward, given that how much we've spoken about him tonight. But the rest of them, I think, look set up quite well. I don't worry about having some single game weekers in there. I think that those single game weekers can do really well this week. So I'm happy to play some.
Nice. All righty. All right, let's have a look at David's then, which I'm guessing is going to differ fairly substantially from Sam's lineup there. This is the David Munday team, and you're bench boosting, Dave.
Yeah, I'm going to be bench boosting. I mean, obviously, people are firstly going to notice it's very Spursless. I think we've covered why that is. I mean, I don't think they're going to do awfully this week. It's just of those players who I would have to sell to get to them, I want to keep them because I like their double game week. My moves I haven't done yet. I've got one free transfer. I'm probably going to be do a minus four to change McCarthy into Areola, who I think is a really good option for this week because of the save potential he's got and clean sheet potential. I have money in the bank so I can get Burn to Luke Shaw, who looks like a really good, exciting differential for the game week considering the Palace game. I think there's a clean sheet there. And even against Chelsea, I think he can create chances. So then I would be bench boosting Areola, Shaw, and Dallas and Bamford. And of course, Sam's just alluded to there, that the Leeds fixture is really nice. In a normal game week, when you're not playing a chip like a bench boost, you would feel like you might want to start them. So to bench boost those four players, I feel quite confident that I can get maybe, 20, maybe even 25 points out of those.
That is a lovely bench boost if you do those transfers, David.
Thanks very much for everyone who sent in questions to @officialFPL. First one out of the bag is from FPL Citizen, who asks, is just one Spurs enough? Kane and Son double up essential? Oh, Sam, go on then.
It's never enough. No, it can be enough. I think it depends on, as David was just saying a minute ago, it depends on the makeup of your team. If you've got to take masses of hits and take out players that you think are going to do well this week, then it's not worth doing. If you've got a player that you're not comfortable with, like if you've got money in the bank and Madison, for example, in your team, then the double up looks on. I think it's very much dependent. For me, the double up is essential given my strategy moving forward towards 29 as well. So if you're looking to do it now because you're not free hitting in 29, also might be worth doing. But taking a minus eight for it, probably not.
Okay.
David, it seems that everyone does want a bit of Harry Kane. The next tweet comes from Steve Finch, who's asking whether Antonio or Bamford should make way for Harry Kane. If you had those two and you had decided to bring Kane in, who would you prefer to get rid of?
I mean, it's probably Antonio because, you'd want to hold Bamford, I imagine. It depends on the chip strategy. I don't know what Steve's chip strategy is, so it could depend there. But Bamford just has more longevity in terms of appeal. And the thing is, West Ham are playing Man City this week, so even if you're just looking at just based on this game week alone, you'd expect more points out of Bamford. So he must have a lot of money in the bank if he's going to do Antonio or Bamford to Kane. If he can afford to make it to Antonio, of course, is the cheaper of the two. I think you should look at that.
OK. Suraj is asking about Fulham players to consider for double game week 26. David's already flagged up a couple in the keeper, Areola, and also Anguissa. Sam, any others you'd like to add to that?
Yeah, I like the man on the graphic. I think Lookman has looked really interesting over the last few weeks. Gets in all the right places, does all the right things. Hasn't necessarily got the level of FPL returns that I would have expected from when I've watched him. He's looked better than he has necessarily got credit for. Fixtures are okay. They're a bit mixed in terms of attacking potential, but as a cheap option moving forward and somebody who also plays in 29, looks good.
Okay. Next tweet comes from Gabby Senior, who is asking, should they triple captain Gundogan? We've actually not talked about the triple captainship yet for this week. What do you reckon, David?
Well, whoever this is, they like to live dangerously, I think. I mean, it's not that it's a bad option, but, when you're playing a triple captain, you would like to be putting it on someone you would be convinced would play twice. So even though I've kind of talked down Harry Kane, for example, I could sooner understand a triple captaincy on Kane in this game week than I could on a Man City player because I think we're too early into a new phase of Man City's season to really trust selection. The Champions League has come back and we don't really know what Pep's kind of outlook on the competition is yet. He's already pulled the rug from under our feet, even at the first stage, I think, by playing more of the bigger players in a relatively easy knockout game. So it is quite difficult, I think, for me to sit here and say that that's a sensible option. It may pay off. Sometimes risky strategies work out, but there's definitely going to be some risk with it.
So here's another quick reminder of all the fixtures for game week 26 and just pointing out yet again that 14 teams have a double, the biggest double game week we've had in FPL. So Sam, where's the captain's armband going?
It will come as a shock to nobody to hear that I am going to give it to to give it to Harry Kane. And in fact, I'm going to trust him with my triple captain.
Are you going to triple captain?
Wow. You're doing it.
Wow. Good for you.
I've been building up to this week for a long, long time.
Wow. Several years, in fact.
Several years.
Two fixtures that, David, you think Spurs are going to blank in. But let's hear about your captaincy pick.
I didn't say that. I just said they're not worth taking a hit for, James.
All right, but who's going to be your captaincy pick? We're really short on time.
Fernandes or Calvert-Lewin. Fernandes the safe pick. Calvert-Lewin is the risky differential pick. So I don't know. I'm not sure. I've got to make a decision.
And you're not thinking of using your triple captain chip because you're using a bench boost?
That's right.
If you did use your triple captain, is there anyone out there who you think is worth it this time?
I don't trust any combination of fixtures. I would like to see someone who can offer... Because I like Everton's fixtures, but I don't like Everton enough to triple captain one of their players. I like Man City, Man United, Liverpool, but I don't trust their fixtures. So this isn't, in my opinion, a triple game week.
All right.
Triple captaincy game week.
And Sam, you're not put off at all by what David said about Spurs. You're going to be doing it. Brilliant. Best of luck, everybody.